where you're storytelling. For the simple reason that we're always narrating somebody else's life or somebody else's experience. Like this morning, one of the speakers mentioned, I think it's about time we speak to women rather than about women. So I do have a problem there about the whole concept of narrating the stories of women. However, having said that, and after listening to her, I'm going to talk to you about some of the stories that have been told. You know, she was speaking about the stories that need to be told, are not sufficiently told, but there are some that have been told. And just because they've been told, say, 100 years ago or centuries ago, and have been read in a certain fashion, it does not mean that we continue to read the same way, because if we continue to do that, then there is no space for social change. I mean, we need to have an agency. We need to have that an impetus. So for that reason, a text as simple as or as complex as Silapadigaram provides fodder for that thinking. Because Silapadigaram is essentially the story of two women. The hero is a prototype, or an alpha male, if you want to call it that, you know. So it's a story about two very strong women, different from each other. But let's keep at the very outside, let's just understand that this is a story told by a man, narrated by one man to another man, who envisioned it using the cultural practices around his time, and you know, whatever the patriarchy that he was being groomed in also must have largely shaped how he saw these women. However, you know, the striking aspects of this text is, I don't know if Ilan Godigle did this purposely or if he managed to do it, and we've been cleverer. You know, sometimes we have these clever interpretations. So if we've been clever in reading a sort of a feminist theory behind some of his writings. You know, in Arangetra Kade, which is one of the first few chapters, he begins by introducing Madhavi to us. And, you know, if Madhavi is to be interpreted from the point of view of having a Kannagi selector, you know, the opposite of that, then we'd be reading her very differently. We'd be reading her like how Kumbhar, the movie, narrated her. As a vamp, don't know what that means yet. As the other woman, as the gold digger, so on and so forth. Right? But that is not at all the narration that Ilan Godigle seems to have wanted, because he says, Sirappil Kundra Seigayod Porundiya, Pirappil Kundra Perindol Madalde. So he does not devalue her lineage at all. However, later on in the text, he does talk about Paratai and Vethiyal and, you know, all of these different minds of different kinds of women. Again, you know, these are all different narratives. So, I mean, the character of Madhavi that he's etched, you know, she keeps going back and forth between her negotiation with the society that she lives in. I'm just going to read a little bit, because I don't want to digress. I'm just going to read a little bit from a small text that I had written a few years ago. And I'm just going to read some of my perspectives of Madhavi. And then I want to tell you the psychic continuum that I see of Madhavi in women today. I mean, if she's supposed to be not Madhavi, a story character, if she's going to be all of us, if there is a Kannagi and if all of us are Kannagi, then what happens? You know, and that I think I've tried to understand, and I think there is a Madhavi and a Kannagi in all of us somewhere. And perhaps even a Manimeyalai. It and many other women. Right, so I mean, So Madhavi makes me think, because when I started doing the dance drama Silapadigaram, I did not want to say this story. I did not want to narrate the story of Silapadigaram. I wanted to talk about just Madhavi, or from Silapadigaram from the point of view of Madhavi. So the pivotal lines within the text, within the poetic text, is Nammai marandare naam marakka maattom. So she says, I will not forget those who forget me, even those who forget me. And this somehow enraged the indignation of her lover, a companion, and he walked out of her life. But the way in which she reacts to this walking out is astounding, because she does not follow him, she does not go back and fall at his feet, she does not beg him to be. Of course, just before this incident happens, Ilan Godigle describes this beautiful space where she's getting decked. You know, she's talking about her dressing up, and it's an elaborate space of alankar, you know, like such beautiful, like she's bathing in a water that's, you know, anointed with 32 different herbs, so on and so forth. And she gets ready and she comes and she's ready to sing poetically to him. And he snatches the harp from her hand and he begins to sing. And then this woman decides to do a repartee with him. And that to me is very, very, is I think very telling. Every mode of poetic, you know, usage that Gillen, I mean that Kovalan uses, she uses the same to give him back an answer. If you go to the text, if you are fortunate to know Tamil, or if you are at least somebody who will be having the, you know, the mind to go and read the translation, you'll understand that for everything he says, she's having a repartee with him, and a very intelligent one, nothing to offend. It's not as if she has subverted exploitation entirely. That's not at all what I'm saying. I mean, she's still very much within the fabric of that patriarchy and that level of exploitation. However, the agency that she has as a woman who comes from a certain lineage, that affords her at the very first paragraph that Ilangodigan says. He says, Purikudal Madhavitane, Adalum Padalum Adagum. So, Adal Padal here literally does not mean music and dance, it also means the knowledge that comes with this understanding of music or any performing arts. So, a very well educated woman, a woman who has been taught to think, actually has an answer, actually speaks to the hero back in his own terms. And I guess that is what enraged Kovalan really more than anything else, because he's upset. Because he says, I compare you to my wife who is docile and who looks down on the earth that she walks upon. And so he huffs away. But once a man huffs away, again, you know, Ilangodigal here again takes a little bit of a surprise. You know, what he does is he says, okay, I'm going to write a letter to you, because that's what lovers do. So this is a very beautiful letter, a love letter, perhaps the first of the later Sangam age. Very beautifully penned, it talks about how the moon is tormenting her and how Lord Manmatha is, you know, throwing his cupids at her and all of that. But there is no question of submission. It only says, look, it is night time. This is not the time lovers are supposed to be separate. Why don't you come back? Okay, so it's a very open invitation saying, you are supposed to come back. Come back. You've lived with me for 13 years. I think it's about time you reconcile with your own self and come back. But of course, the man doesn't come back, and that's when he launches into this, again, here again I see that Ilangodigal has given us a sort of a, you know, if you want, a microscope into looking at the psyche of the man. Because until then, she is everything to him. And then just when he realizes she's the talking type, you know, she becomes 13 varieties of deceit. And he launches into how many varieties of deceit she has indulged in over the years that she's been with him. Of course, starting from the fact that she's after all a dancer, okay? And then she's after all a woman. And then she's after all X and Y and all of that. So he says all this, and then she writes another letter. Now is where I think the idea of diplomacy, the idea of agency, and her ability to hold on to who she thinks she is really comes forth. Because this second letter to me is phenomenal. It says, Adigal Munnar Yaan Adi Vilde, Vadiya Piyavi Manak Konal Vedu. So she says she doesn't make any reference to love anymore. No companionship, no coming back, nothing. So she says, look, you are a man with a wife. You're supposed to be respectful. You have your parents in this city. Whatever makes you run away, fled this place overnight, without so much as a goodbye to even your own parents, where is your sense of propriety? Why don't you make a better exit? And I bow to you to be the man that you are supposed to be. And she leaves it there. She doesn't say come back. And I think that's where he shows this very fine difference between how he's going to etch Kannagi's character. Because until then, the only few references to Kannagi is she being the very sweet bride, and then the woman who's forlorn because her husband is not with her, and who keeps looking down at the ground for 13 years and walking back and forth, waiting for her husband. And the minute he walks in after this, she's supposed to have just taken him back without questions. And that is that moment that we hail as Patinitvam, or whatever else we have, you know, we have found as the greatest virtues to be etched in stone. Unfortunately or fortunately for us, it's a great reminder. Every day when I come to this department, I keep looking at it and I'm wondering, what is it that, you know, I mean, how are we to, you know, how are we to have dialogue? I mean, we don't have to necessarily oppose it, but how are we to dialogue with this mindset? Because that is a big challenge. But as I said, this continuum, yeah. As I said, this continuum from Kannagi, I'm sorry, from Madhavi to Thiruvarapputur Kalyani Amman. You know, she is my guru's guru. I learned from the Thiruvarapputur Kalyani granddaughters. So she's my guru's grandmother. A woman who lived in Padanallur, she was very young when she was dedicated as a Devadasi from a very big lineage of the Trivadakapur family. She was a wonderful artist, direct disciple of Pannanallur Meenakshi Pillai, who was a great doyen of her. Of course, you know, rumors had it that, you know, she had a little liking for her guru, and the guru was also greatly enamored by the prowess. She was not particularly beautiful, so to speak, you know, if you had any standards of beauty at all. But, you know, she was very talented. But then, of course, you know, when her mother found a suitable companion for her, one man from somewhere else, a zamindar, supposedly from nearby village, she was sent with him. She went away, she was living with him. But the man found every opportunity to taunt her. Every time he had an opportunity, apparently he would tell her, I know you had a liaison, I know you had a sort of a licentious relationship with your guru, I'm sure that's your character. And he would poke her and prick her, and the woman got pregnant and she was sent back home for delivery. But when she came back home, the mother of Tiruvallapattu Kalyanamma told her, go pay a visit to your guru and take his blessings. This innocent act, like Nammai Marandare Naam Marakamatam, as innocent as that was, turned out, you know, that her fate was completely changed. The husband or the companion knew of it. He blew his top and he said, I know that's what you've gone there for, so might as well stay back there. So here was Kannaki Madhavi with the 13-year-old Manimegalai left in the lurch just because she spoke. Here was Tiruvallapattu Kalyanamma, who was left with a baby to fend for, or two babies rather, to fend for, because she stepped out of that zone and acted within the space that originally meant her identity, you know, which is being a dancer. You know, she had to step out of that identity, she had to completely submit to being this companion of another. Now, set aside the fact that she was only a companion and he had two families before, that's another story. That's a different story. No, but, you know, so this happened. So Tiruvallapattu Kalyanamma, in her later life, became this matriarch. She brought her two daughters up so beautifully, I mean, and she married Meenakshi Pillai. Because she said, look, if this is what you're going to accuse me of, might as well make it the truth. You see? So she went and married him, and he married her. He actually said, look, if I brought this upon you, I think it's only fair I give you a life. Or, you know, so when he gave her children, and they had this family, and then she was a matriarch. You know, and after that she started writing poetry, she started writing translations of various poems and all that. So I have a great example of a Madhavi in her. And many of our own lives, I mean, I see so much of Madhavi's character even in my own life, because every corner I turn, no matter how much I study, no matter whatever I do, wherever I go, my first label is, it's not actress that's a problem, it's, oh, you're an actress. It's the tonality with which it comes. That makes me, and every time it's a beautiful reminder of Madhavi, so I'm not at all offended by it. I mean, just on the record, you know. So I mean, I feel very privileged to be associated with Thirappil Kundra Perindol Madhavi. The same kind of continuum I can also see in Kannagi and Manimegalai, but without taking much of your time, I'll just quickly draw this one thing between Kannagi. And you know, Kannagi, we all know she was, you know, she had righteous indignation, if I should say, only rightly placed for her husband's injustice, not for her own. You know, I mean, all her anger is directed towards the men, for the cause of a man. She is sort of the agent in this whole thing, and hence she is, you know, hate-worthy, right? In many ways, this idea of Kannagi and this idea of righteous indignation for the man, you know, I was able to find in somebody like Gandhi, right? Somebody who had been, you know, deeply, I mean, there was a lot of injustice in her story, in her life. But the main cause for her to rebel, the main cause for her to become who she became, was because her lover of so many years was shot down by the upper caste men. And so she went around, you know, like on a rampage of killing all the men of that caste. And you know, she's deified, Kannagi is deified, Phulan Devi is deified. They're looking at her as a figure of not resistance, but as somebody who can resist against a certain kind of patriarchy from within the patriarchy. So, you know, I mean, there are so many stories within Silapadigaram. I mean, just to talk about Silapadigaram, I think we need an entire symposium. The finesse with which the writer, sometimes like I wonder how he's, or a Kshetriya, for example, you know, a Padam writer, a Javali writer, you know, the subtle nuances that they have employed, and setting it within the patriarchy, and subverting the patriarchy. To me, these problematics those are more interesting than the black and white of storytelling. So I really urge everybody to read and reread literature or narratives, because one reading is only the writer's reading and the writer's perspective. Perhaps, I mean, if you're lucky, you get the writer's perspective, but I don't think that's everything. The writer's job ends at writing. It is the reader's job to reinterpret, and I think that's where lies the juices within us to be able to go past this running lane without really getting caught up every day. Thank you so much for this wonderful opportunity, and I hope all of you become storytellers of a very different kind in your future. Thank you.
Thank you.
10 to 12 minutes.
Yes.
So we have about 40 minutes then for their presentation.
Right. We have 10 to 12 minutes after that.
You know that she performed this for the sake of honor and for her husband and her community, and she is looked at as a sort of a virtue queen of the Rajput community. And even those women who barely knew about her back then are writing this entire thing very differently today, because now they think it's Rajput pride. Very, very similar, you know, if I can border on that sensitive issue of the Jallikattu protests. You know, there were so many sub-protests and so many sub-narratives that were going on, that I think the main narrative itself was lost after a point. You see? And many of them didn't know why they were there. They were there because they wanted to support their college. They were there because they wanted to support their community. Those things like that. So I think that kind of hyperventilation is wrong and it's harmful. I mean, when we say wrong, it's not like we can do much about it. That's going to happen. We just need mechanisms to moderate those things from time to time, which is, I think, moderate, like writings, good writings, and I don't know, spaces like this, where we can at least intellectualize it and break it down and break the rhetoric down. That's all I think we can do.
Can
I just story that's being written within the subaltern space, it has a lot more scope to become mainstream, because it's a new age narrative. But if it's a literature, for example, or if it's something that's within a cultural space, then it's very, like, for example, I mean, no matter how many books are being written about, I mean, centering Madhuri or Gandhi, Silpathikaram's focus is going to be Kovalam. And, you know, and how these two women fought over him. So that for that narrative to go from subaltern to mainstream is problematic, one. The second thing is, there is an inherent danger within that, because once you may move it to that sort of a stream, where you hyperventilate about the women and the feminism within that, you also deify her, because that's what's happened to Gandhi, right? You know, you deified her to a point where today, you know, you have a temple, I mean, not today, you've had it for centuries, but, you know, this whole deification of the female figure, and then again, all that's also still very problematic. So I don't know, maybe it should remain subaltern.
Yes.